Hi, I'm Patricia Corrales, or Patty Corrales. I was a former ICE senior attorney with the Department of Homeland Security for a period of 17 years. I'm here to discuss the I-601 provisional waivers, that hardship waivers that will allow some immigrants to get the waivers here before they go to the consulate to adjust. I'm here today with my colleagues who are joining me to discuss this new provisional waiver, Joaquin Talleda and Eric Lockwood from the Law Offices of Braden Concilia. Joaquin, could you introduce yourself, please?
Sure. Thanks, Patty. My name is Joaquin Talleda. I'm an immigration attorney, been practicing immigration law since 1995, and my offices are located in Pasadena.
And Eric?
Good afternoon. My name is Eric Lockwood. I'm also an immigration attorney. I've been practicing immigration law since 2006, and I'm of counsel at the Law Offices of Braden Concilia, and it's a pleasure to be here today with both of you.
Well, thank you. As I said, we're here to discuss the new I-601A provisional extreme hardship waivers, and I want to share a little bit about this new provisional waivers. On March 30th, 2012, the Department of Homeland Security posted a notice of proposed rulemaking, and basically they outlined a plan to reduce the time that U.S. citizens are separated from their immediate relative spouses, children, and parents, while those family members are in the process of obtaining an immigrant visa to become lawful permanent residents in the United States. This would mean that an immigrant's visa will be issued without unnecessary delay. And more importantly, it would reduce the period of separation between the immigrant and his U.S. citizen spouse or parent or child. It would allow the immigrant to obtain the waiver for the unlawful presence here in the United States, and the hardship waiver, let him or she obtain that hardship waiver here in the United States before going to the consulate. And we're going to discuss how that works and the requirements for that. But I'd like to just give, and I think this is a good thing, don't you think, for the immigrant community? It's going to certainly reduce the delay time. And what do you think, Juan?
Oh, I think this is a huge, huge step by the government to ensure family unity and make sure that families can stay together.
Do you think this goes hand in hand with the prosecutorial discretion and the deferred action that the department has announced just recently?
Well,
is this all in favor of family unity?
Absolutely. These are steps taken by the administration to assist the immigrant community in ways that is within their power. Both of these steps are great steps that they've taken. They don't substitute for comprehensive immigration reform, which I think we desperately need, but they're great steps.
I agree. I definitely agree that we do need comprehensive immigration reform. They are some steps, baby steps, if you will, to allow immigrants to have benefits in this country and to allow them to stay as lawful permanent residents. As a prosecutor with the Department of Homeland Security, I know that this I-601A provisional waiver was being sought by the immigrant community. Joaquin, can you tell us a little bit about how the program exists today if this provisional waiver, this new provisional waiver, was not in place?
Sure. Right now, somebody that is trying to fix their residency, somebody who's in the United States and trying to fix their residency through a family member or an employee, but mainly it's employer, mainly it's family members, unless they're covered by two very narrow provisions of the law, they will have to leave the United States and finish fixing their papers in their home country.
And that's why you need the waiver, right?
The waiver's needed because somebody who has been here unlawfully present for a certain period of time, whether it's 6 months in one case or a year in another, and then leave the country, it's the act of leaving the country that makes them inadmissible for a period of either 3 or 10 years. That means that they cannot come back for 3 or 10 years unless they get a waiver of that 3 or 10 year bar.
And currently, in order to obtain the waiver, they'd have to leave the United States and get that waiver, apply for that waiver at the consulate or the embassy. And that itself is a process that may take quite some time. It can take months, it can take years, right?
Yes, currently right now, let's take Mexico as an example because that's where the largest volume is. Somebody will finish the paperwork that they have to do here in the United States. They will go to their interview in Ciudad Juarez. And if they're subject to the 3 or 10 year bar for having been unlawfully present, they then have to apply and for a hardship waiver, the I-601. They will have to make an appointment to do that at that point, and it's taking 2 to 3 months just to get the appointment. So they wait outside 2 or 3 months, then apply for the waiver. If the waiver application is so strong, and I'll go into what is strong or not in a moment, if it is so strong that it can be granted right there, yes, it'll be granted at that second interview, and they're able to come back, but they've still been separated for 2 or 3 months. If the officer determines that it's not sufficiently strong, they will refer the application back to an office here in the United States for further processing. That could take 6 months, a year. And that would mean a separation of that period. And if, at the end of that period, if they say no, then the full 3 or 10 year bar is in place, and we're talking a extremely long 3 or 10 year separation. So it is a very risky proposition to leave the United States right now and ask for that waiver outside of the country.
Now, you talked about requirements, and we're going to talk about the requirements for a hardship waiver. But Eric, tell me if you can, you know, Joaquin talked to us right now about how long the process could take, possibly, mm-hmm. and what a risk it is to immigrants. What sort of requirements today before this, what sort of requirements today, if you will, does the government look at as to whether or not there is hardship in a case?
So there's a variety of factors, and what you're trying to do in assisting a client is really to gather as much evidence as you can showing that if the moment that the immigrant is separated from their family members, that the family member is going to suffer extreme hardship, and that could be medical hardship, that could be emotional hardship, that's a relevant factor, financial hardship if the departing family member is the breadwinner in the family, that can have severe consequences in the family life. So there's a series of factors that you're looking at, and you're really trying to ask questions about all of those different things, because the strongest waiver applications are going to include as much information speaking to hardship as possible.
And my understanding is that the new I-601 provisional hardship waivers that the department has proposed won't necessarily change what it is when you say it's an extreme hardship, correct? Would that be fair to say?
That's correct. They are not changing the law. They're not changing the legal requirement, only the process under which you apply for the waiver.
Okay, so let's talk about how that process is going to change. Joaquin shared with us what the current process is and how risky it is if immigrants leave the United States to try to adjust their status in a consulate outside the United States. What the proposed process would do. Under the proposed process, immediate relatives of a United States citizen who would need a waiver of the unlawful presence in order to obtain an immigrant visa would file a new form I-601A. It's called an application of provisional unlawful presence waiver. They would apply for that before leaving the United States to obtain an immigrant visa at a U.S. embassy or a consulate abroad. All individuals eligible for this process would still have to depart the United States and meet all other legal requirements in order to be issued an immigrant visa and in order to show that they're admissible into the United States. But what this does is you leave the United States with the waiver in hand, and it certainly is supposed to delay the length, if you will, of how long it takes to process that immigrant visa, so there is less time of separation between the families. Is that essentially what the new provisional waiver is intended to do?
That's exactly what it's supposed to do. One of the issues is that they will only grant the provisional waiver if the only problem that you have is the inadmissibility or the bar because you were unlawfully present. If you have any other problems, they won't issue it. That way, if they grant the waiver, you leave knowing that the only problem that you have has already been pardoned, and you should be able to come back immediately.
Okay, so what happens, Eric or Joaquin, if, you know, I got the waiver, but I go to the consulate and somehow they find out I have a criminal conviction? How does that impact my ability to come back? well, immigrants' ability to come back into the United States.
Well, my understanding is that you're as Joaquin was saying, you're only eligible for this I-601A provisional waiver if the only ground of inadmissibility that you have is unlawful presence. So if you have, for instance, a criminal conviction that would render you inadmissible under the immigration laws, then you wouldn't qualify. And you would have to apply for another waiver for that specific, to waive that criminal conviction. There's other grounds of inadmissibility as well that you might be subject to. If you're subject to any of those, then again, you would not qualify for this provisional waiver.
And I think I think that's important to make, you know, clear, because I've, in my my few months here joining you both as advocates for the immigrant community, I've heard different things. A lot of the immigrants that I've spoken to, they believe that this I-601 provisional waiver is, if you will, an end-all and be-all to all immigration issues that they may have, and it's not. It just allows you, you're only eligible, as Joaquin and you said, if you have the issue of unlawful presence. But if you have any other issues, this is not the solution. You're going to have to apply for other waivers. Is that right?
That's right. I mean, and don't get me wrong. I mean, it's not the be-all, end-all, but it is still a huge and very favorable change in the law, because the majority of people here, the only problem that they have is that they have been here in an undocumented status for a certain period of time, and they've done nothing else wrong. So for them, if they are, in most cases, married to a United States citizen, they will be able to apply for the provisional waiver, and if they get it, they'll be able to immigrate without facing the risks that currently exist.
And we talked about, we're going to talk about the requirements, but Joaquin, you touched on something that I thought was very important, and that is, you said that unless they fit into these very two specific categories, most people, most immigrants who are here unlawfully would have to apply for this provisional waiver. One of those limited circumstances is if an individual or an immigrant is eligible to adjust their status under 245I, is that right?
That's correct.
What's the other one?
245A, that is an immediate relative, that is the spouse of a United States citizen, the parent of a United States citizen, or the child, single under 21, of a United States citizen. Those are immediate relatives. If they entered the United States with inspection, which more or less legally, or are otherwise here in lawful status, they can fix their status, adjust their status here without having to leave.
Okay.
But that's very limited.
It is very limited. And as you said, you know, the most of the issues that most immigrants face here is the fact that they're here unlawfully. And so, as you said, Joaquin and Eric, you echoed this. This provisional waiver is a good thing for the immigrant community. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the requirements of this provisional waiver. You have to at least be 17 years of age. Would you agree?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a series of requirements that you have to meet in order to be eligible for this provisional waiver. And I think it'd be helpful to just kind of go through one by one and explain what those requirements are, so that people are aware of the requirements they have to meet. So as you mentioned, you have to be at least 17 years old. You have to be physically present in the United States.
What are some other requirements, Joaquin?
Well, as we've already touched on, you cannot have any other grounds of inadmissibility. You cannot have prior deportations or deportation orders pending against you. And you still have to show the extreme hardship to your United States citizen, spouse, or parent. The hardship to children do not count.
And that's sometimes very difficult for immigrants to understand, that why hardship to their children don't count, but that's just the way the law is as it's written today. But I think one of the other important requirements, and correct me if I'm wrong, gentlemen, is the fact that they cannot, when they apply for this waiver, they cannot already have an appointment at the consulate. Is that true?
That's correct. That's what's been proposed thus far, yes.
So if they do have, the way they are looking at this, when I say they, I'm talking about the Department of Homeland Security, is that if you already have an appointment at the consulate or an embassy for your to process your immigrant visa, you would not be eligible for this provisional waiver. Is that correct?
That's correct. I mean, understand, they published the proposed rulemaking on March 31st, I think it was. We're waiting to hear the final details. And that is an area that I'm waiting for a lot of clarification, because I've had quite a few clients that already had their appointment, mm-hmm. and I strongly suggested they not keep it and they just abandon that application. And now they could possibly start again. So the question that I will have with them is, does the fact that they 2 or 3 years ago tried to do this and then decided to stop after they had an appointment scheduled, is that going to bar them? Don't know yet, waiting to hear. But in the way it was proposed, it was, if you have an appointment scheduled already, you're not eligible.
And to me, frankly, that doesn't make any sense. I mean, if the goal is to delay the process and to certainly, you know, create more, if you will, let's say less separation between the families, if the goal is family unity, to make that the sticking point, if someone already has a visa appointment at the consulate or embassy, just to me does not make any logical sense. And so I hope that in the final proposed, or in the final rules, if you will, that that is a provision that either has more clarification or just goes away, if you will, and that that shouldn't be a bar to someone's eligibility for this. Any other eligibility requirements?
Well, you have to be the beneficiary of what's known as an I-130 visa petition. So that has to already be in the pipeline. You have to be already have received an approval notice on that to qualify for the provisional waiver. And in addition, there's sort of a bureaucratic hurdle of paying the appropriate processing fees. And once you've done that, at that moment, at least under the proposed regulations, you would be eligible to apply for the provisional waiver.
So the fees haven't been paid yet, then you're not eligible.
That's correct.
Okay. And how do we know how much the fees are?
I believe that according to the proposed regulations, they're going to keep the current fee structure in place. And right now, it's I believe $585 for the I-601, or in this case, it'll be the I-601A. And then, depending on your age, most applicants will have to complete biometrics, which means fingerprints. And there's a cost of $85 associated with that as well.
All right. And can you think of any other requirements that would be necessary for someone to be eligible for the I-601 provisional waiver?
I think we've hit the main ones, and again, it's the legal standard for extreme hardship, from what we know, is not going to change. So the documentation that you need to submit to show extreme hardship to that U.S. citizen family member, parent or spouse, that doesn't change.
Is the requirement of extreme hardship the same type of requirements or the same type of showing that an immigrant has to make with cancellation of removal?
No, cancellation of removal is for people that are in removal or deportation proceedings and they've been here for a certain period of time, at least 10 years, and they have U.S. citizen family. To avoid deportation and get their permanent residence, they have to show exceptional and extremely unusual hardship to obtain that. That is a much higher level of hardship than is required at the extreme hardship level for the I-601 or the I-601A waiver that we're talking about here.
And I would agree with you, but I recently talked to an immigrant from Mexico who was denied a waiver at the consulate, and in his case, he had a young son who had medical issues and was hospitalized at the university hospital at Nervine, and I would have thought that something like that would have qualified as an extreme hardship. What do they want? What are they looking for, if you know?
Again, as we talked about a moment ago, Patty, it's not hardship to the children, it's hardship to the spouse.
All right, so
the fact that the child is needing these medical attention could be viewed as irrelevant. Now, if the case is properly documented, you don't talk about, oh, the child is gonna suffer this, you talk about
the
mother and what she's gonna have to deal with dealing with a sick child. And that's how that should be presented. I don't know what happened in that case and whether it was just not presented correctly.
I agree with you, because when I reviewed the case, I myself said the same thing, that they need to focus on the hardship that it would be on the mother. But why is it that it's not hardship to the children? Do you know? Do either of you have any idea why they've made that, why the government has decided that that doesn't count, not relevant?
When they, back in 1997, when they adopted some very arcane immigration changes in a law called IRA, Illegal Immigration Reform and Immigrant Responsibility Act, they came down with some extremely difficult laws to make it very difficult for people to immigrate. And one of the requirements was they brought in this 10-year bar and 3-year bar. And they said, for reasons that make no sense to me.
Or me.
You know, only hardship to the U.S. citizen spouse or parent. And my guess is that their thinking is, we don't want these undocumented people to benefit from having children here. So that's the only thing that I could think of. Is it fair? Is it just? Is it humane? No, but that's my guess, that's the rationale.
And that itself is a topic that can take quite a bit of discussion. I did a lot of work on that topic of immigrants having children here in the United States. That said, and that's for another day that we can talk about. Now, the I-601A provisional waiver, that's new. The waiver to be able to apply for a waiver here before leaving to the consulate or the embassy, that's new. But the process isn't new, right, Eric? So people can actually begin gathering all the information, making certain that they've got an approved visa before they apply for this I-601A waiver, even though there's no such waiver available. Is that correct?
That's exactly right, yeah. And I think within the next few months, hopefully we'll have a final rule that will tell us exactly how these procedures are going to work, and that will tell us what the form is going to look like, the form I-601A. But as you said, Patty, there's no reason you can't, at this point in time, begin getting yourself ready by filing, for instance, an I-130 visa petition on behalf of your family member. And that way you've got a head start, so that rather than starting once the rule has actually come out in final form and starting at that point, you can save yourself several months by starting now and getting that application in the pipeline.
And you talked about when the rule will be final, if you will, when they will actually have the I-601A application available for the public. My understanding is that that's going to happen sometime in October. We'll see, but I hear in October that's going to be coming down the pipeline. Other than the I-130, what other recommendations do you have for immigrants to get ready for this?
Well, they know that they're going to have to show extreme hardship, and there are documentation that you're going to have to present with your I-601A. You should start getting that documentation ready now. If there are any medical issues for anybody, start documenting. If there are any emotional issues, financial issues, any of those things, you can start documenting those. If we're talking about a U.S. citizen spouse that was born here and has lived here all their life, well, they're not going to go live in a foreign country. They're here. Document those roots. Start getting the documentation together.
And I think that's one of the, I'll tell you that one of the weaknesses I would see in applications before the immigration courts when I was a senior attorney with the Department of Homeland Security is that there wasn't enough documentation. People didn't do enough, immigrants didn't do enough to document the hardship, either to their children or their spouse or their parent when they were applying for relief applications. And I think, Joaquin, you bring up a very important point in that, and Eric, you too, that immigrants today can start gathering all this information waiting in anticipation for this new I-601A provisional waiver to come down. And documentation is absolutely crucial in order to substantiate a hardship waiver. But as Joaquin said, and as we said earlier, I think all of us would be in agreement that this is a good thing for the immigrant community. Do you think there's anything else that our immigrant community should know about?
I think that one thing that's important to talk about is that, unfortunately, within the immigration community, there's a lot of fraud. And when I say fraud, on the part of notarios or unlicensed practitioners who are trying to take advantage of immigrants, not giving them proper advice, and basically, you know, trying to scam them. So it's very, very important in beginning this process to consult with a licensed, competent, ethical attorney. You can oftentimes go to uscis.gov, and they have very useful question and answer pages and announcements that explain to you what's going on. And so it's very important to be careful so that you don't end up in a situation where you're getting advice from someone who's not qualified to give you advice.
That's a very good point. It's always important for our immigrant community not to be taken advantage of. These are people who come to this country to seek better benefits, to seek a better life. They work very hard, and it's often, you know, quite sad, actually, and tragic when they get taken advantage of by people who are not licensed attorneys here in the United States. But at the same time, well, the government is doing a good thing in these I-601 provisional waivers. We're also hearing that other possible relief applications may be taken away, like the VAWA application. Have you heard anything about that?
Well, VAWA is Violence Against Women Act, and the Violence Against Women Act is a law that is there to protect victims of domestic violence, mainly, and for many years has been a way for people who have been victims of domestic violence to seek the protections of the government and legalize their immigration status. And by its terms, VAWA, Violence Against Women Act, will be terminating soon unless it is extended by the government. And right now it looks like the House of Representatives is holding up an extension of VAWA. And that's in my view, a terrible thing.
I agree, Joaquin. It's a very terrible thing for women because there are many women who are victims of domestic violence. But I could also understand, and certainly this is for another day, and we can have a very long discussion. There is also much fraud in that program, but there's fraud in any kind of benefit application program that the government puts forth. In any event, I think we've covered the I-601A provisional waivers that are scheduled to be finalized, if you will, sometime in October. If you have any further questions, you can contact me at patricia.m.corrales, C-O-R-R-A-L-E-S, at gmail.com. And Joaquin and Eric, if people need to get a hold of you, or if our immigrant community has any further questions, how can they reach you?
Me, again, my name is Joaquin Talleda, and my email address at my office is, it's a little weird, LOJAT@ymail.com.
And Eric?
It's been a pleasure being here with both of you. You can reach me at ATTY.Lockwood, LOCKWOOD, at gmail.com, and I'd be happy to be of assistance.
Well, thank you. Again, I hope this public service announcement on the I-601 waiver or provisional waiver was very helpful. Again, if you have any further questions, I look forward to hearing from you.